Now we have André Di Carvalho from the Institute of Mathematics of the State University of São Paulo.
Obrigado. So I'm supposed to speak English, right? Yeah. Thank you. Okay, so I brought some toys, and then if you don't want to pay attention to what I'm saying, you can look at this, perhaps. So it's interesting not just because of the so these are meant to be models of the hyperbolic plane, okay? But it's interesting because of the model, but it's also interesting because of the material, which is, so if you want to pass these around. I mean, they're just two different versions with filled in. All right, so I'm gonna. Is this hissing? It's better now, is it? Okay. So, anyways, so this is the first time I give a talk in a history of math conference. So I'm not sure how I'm gonna do, but anyways, so let's try. So I'm gonna talk about Poincaré and Thurston mostly. and then I'm going to talk a bit about these other guys, but so the idea of the talk is to kind of take a walk through some parts of math that were, you know, initiated with Poincaré's work, and you know, I'm going to take a path that takes from the late 1980s, I think, to the late 1970s, with the work of Thurston mostly, and I'll, you know, I take some more or less geodesic path between, you know, 1880 and 1978 or 79, and we'll talk about some subjects mostly, you know, related to complex analysis, hyperbolic geometry, and dynamics, but anyway, what. So if you look around a little more, and if you see everything that is involved, you really have to touch on many, many things that Poincaré dealt with, and many others, but, you know, but many areas that were actually initiated by Poincaré, like Kleinian and Fuchsian groups, ergodic theory, and many other things. Okay. Oh, it's falling apart? Anyway. So I'll start with talking about the uniformization theorem, which is one of these important theorems. Well, it's one of the most important theorems of the 20th century, which was proved in 1907 by both Poincaré and Kuba. So they both published proofs in 1907. So Kuba's proof, I think, appeared first. Poincaré's proof appeared a little bit later, but anyway. And what the uniformization theorem says is that that a simply connected Riemann surface is isomorphic to one of three possibilities: the Riemann sphere, the complex plane, or the upper half plane. And just so a Riemann surface is a surface covered by coordinate charts that overlaps or are conformal, and to be simply connected means that every loop can be squeezed to a point. Okay? So every simply connected surface, Riemann surface, is holomorphically equivalent to either the Riemann sphere, the plane, or the upper half plane. Now, so it's not, well, so this implies rather quickly that every Riemann surface now can be obtained as the quotient of one of these three simply connected Riemann surfaces by the action of a discrete group of automorphisms. Right? So so any surface now, any Riemann surface now, can be obtained from one of these three as a quotient. No, right? So this, but because by automorphism, right? By a group of automorphisms. Now, because of the automorphisms of the upper half space, so the sphere has no automorphisms without fixed points. So the plane, very simple automorphism, they're really only translations and stuff. And the hyperbolic plane, well, the upper half plane is also sometimes called a Poincaré, well, I don't know, the Poincaré disk, right? But in any case, so the upper half plane has the so-called hyperbolic metric, which I think Poincaré was one of the first people to use this more systematically in other, but I don't know. Maybe you guys, well, you certainly know this better than I do. But in any case, so this hyperbolic metric is preserved by the conformal automorphisms of age, and therefore, the upshot of this this very quick discussion is that every surface has a natural metric. A natural metric, which is very homogeneous, right? So this, for example, well, the sphere S2, which is just the Riemann sphere, has a natural metric of constant curvature 1. Just take the sphere inside of R3, that has a natural metric with constant curvature everywhere, is very homogeneous, constant curvature 1. Now the plane also has a very natural metric, which is the Euclidean metric, and then all its quotients also have this natural metric, like this, the cylinders and tori all have inherit this Euclidean metric from the plane. And well, since all other surfaces, Riemann surfaces, are covered, the universal cover of these surfaces is the upper half plane, and since all automorphisms preserve this Poincaré metric, they all inherit this metric of constant negative curvature. Minus one, which this model that I was passing around is exactly a discrete model of what the hyperbolic plane, this hyperbolic metric, is. Right? I mean, so in this model there, it was discretized, and the curvature is all concentrated on these vertices. Anyway, so in the late 70s, Thurston proposed an analogous description for three manifolds. You know, the uniformization theorem is 1907, and you know, 78, 79, I think Thurston proposed this geometrization conjecture, which, you know, said like this is not a direct analog, but anyway, that's what it is. I mean, three manifolds are much more complicated topologically, and then what Thurston proposed is that every three manifold, which is reasonably behaved topologically, can be decomposed into pieces, and then you cut it up into several pieces, and each one of these pieces has a natural geometric structure. Now, these natural geometric structures, well, they can be the direct analogs to three dimensions of the two-dimensional versions. They can be the sphere S3, the Euclidean space R3, and hyperbolic 3 space, which again is a three-dimensional space that has constant curvature minus 1. Now, in dimension 3 again, there are some other versions, other things that have to be considered homogeneous metric structures, such as products, for example. You could have an R cross S2 type geometry, or an R cross H2 type geometry. In one direction you have zero curvature, in the other direction you have minus one or one, and then there are three more possibilities that Thurston also lists. Anyway, so he proposed this as a conjecture in 78 or 79, I don't know. But you know, just as in dimension 2, you see, so in dimension 2, with the few exceptions that you list, right, all other possibilities have hyperbolic geometry, right? All Riemann surfaces have hyperbolic geometry, with a few exceptions, like the plane or the sphere or tori and stuff. And here the same thing is the case, that you know, it's hyperbolic geometry that has that has you know, the most sort of significant part in the story, and the other ones you can sort of list in some reasonable understanding of listing. So Thurston himself proved some very important cases of this conjecture, and along the way, just I think like Poincaré here, introduced an enormous amount of very original and amazing sort of inventive mathematics. But the final proof of this, of the conjecture, was given by Perelman in about 2000. And he proved in particular the Poincaré conjecture, which Fernando Kodá is going to give a talk about a bit later on today. So I'll talk about one of these theorems of Thurston's that proves, you know, gives a geometrization statement for certain kinds of three manifolds, which is specially related to dynamics. And the three manifolds I'm going to talk about are these so-called suspension manifolds. So one very simple way of producing three manifolds is start with the two manifold, the surface, and a self map of the surface, and then you do the obvious thing. You just take the surface, multiply by the interval, and then glue this side to this side by the map. Okay, so that's a way of producing a three manifold. If you start with a compact surface, you get a compact three manifold. And this is called the suspension or the mapping torus. The suspension is more the dynamical sort of term, and mapping torus is more the topological. Anyway, so this is a way of producing three manifolds. And Thurston proved a geometrization theorem for such three manifolds, which I'll explain. But so first of all, the homeomorphism type of this manifold depends only on the isotopy class of the map. That is, if you deform the map by an isotopy, or if you deform the map continuously into another map, then the two three manifolds that you obtain are homeomorphic. So so you really are not talking so much about the map as about its isotopy class. You can, but in order to understand the statement of this geometrization theorem of Thurston's, we need another to state another theorem of Thurston's, which is also very important and incredibly original. So the proof of this theorem involves many techniques also, in class, you know, compactified Stockmiller spaces, a whole slew of you know, new techniques that Thurston introduced. So in any case, so this theorem classifies isotopy classes of surface homeomorphisms, and those are called mapping classes. This is just the jargon from the field somehow. So here's this classification theorem. So you start with a surface of finite topological type. We're not talking about what we're talking about here, compact surfaces or compact surfaces from which you've taken out, you know, finitely many points or disks or something. So then the isotopy class of F is of one of three types. So the one type that it can be is that it's of finite order. Now, so what this means is that so you can compose maps, but you can also compose isotopy classes, and that's a well-defined operation. You just you compose isotopy classes, and that makes the set of isotopy classes into a group. And then it may well be that the isotopy class, which really is what interests us to build the three manifold, that this isotopy class is got finite order in the group. You just compose it with itself finitely many times, and you get back to the identity. That's a possibility, and that, you know, that's there. So there's another possibility, which is to say that the map is reducible. Now, to say that it's reducible is that it doesn't really live on this surface S, it lives on a simpler surface. And what you should really do is to cut up your surface into topologically simpler pieces and look at the return map to each one of the pieces. Okay? So you can reduce, and then you can, you know, just defer your thing to other cases, to simpler cases. But if it's not of any of these two types, it's of a third type. Okay? And this third type is called Pseudo-Nozov. Okay? And the Pseudo-Nozov situation, the case, is the most interesting and most relevant dynamically, and it's also the most common. You know, in some statistical sense, if you pick a homeomorphism at random, it's probably going to be Pseudo-Nozov in some. So the theorem is going to use this, the geometrization theorem that I'm going to state is going to use these three possibilities here. But I want to explain a little more what this third possibility is, and that's where dynamics comes into the story. Um, Because it's it's where dynamics comes into the story, and it's also the most interesting case from the dynamical point of view, but also from the geometric point of view, as you'll see when we get to the theorem. So let me give a definition of Pseudo-Nozov, which is kind of a historical definition or historical description, which will then. So here's the famous prize essay, as it couldn't be left out. So there's this famous error of Poincaré that did not quite observe that this so-called homoclinic intersections led to problems in convergence of series and whatnot. But in any case, what this is that you have some dynamical system, say a self diffeomorphism of a piece of the plane to itself, and then you have a fixed point here, say, and it has unstable and unstable manifolds, and these things intersect at some other point, transversely. It's called a transverse homoclinic intersection, and such things led Poincaré to make those statements about, oh, this is really mysterious and very deep, and I don't want to even go there. But you should go, like Jacquot was saying, that that's where he found inspiration for going on. So that was Poincaré. And Birkhoff, I don't know how much later, in fact I couldn't even find the reference where Birkhoff, but I remember, and I'm not crazy like Etienne said this morning, I remember seeing this in some paper or some book of Birkhoff's, where he draws, so he was interested in these homoclinic tangles, so-called homoclinic tangles, and he drew pictures of these things and started trying to classify them somehow and describe the pictures you see emerging from the existence of transverse homoclinic orbits. I haven't been able to find the reference again, but in any case, I'm sure it exists somewhere. And he, I think, was the first one in particular to show that, if you have a homoclinic fixed point or periodic point with a homoclinic intersection, this point is actually accumulated by periodic orbits. I think that was Birkhoff who first showed that. So in fact, you have to have infinitely many periodic behaviors in any small neighborhood of your periodic point. But it was Smale, sort of maybe on the beaches of Copacabana, maybe the IMPA library, there's some discussion as to where it happened. But in any case, who clarified the situation by introducing his horseshoe map. Right? So Smale was, I think, the first one to say, well, here is a model for how you produce and how you understand a homoclinic intersection. So this map here kind of takes a square, squeezes it vertically, stretches horizontally, and folds. So this point goes to that point. And there's some fixed point here somewhere that has a homoclinic intersection, much like that one over there. And then Smale gave this quite complete description of the dynamics of such a map and chaos, unpredictability, this, that, and the other. And then I think kind of several decades of work and contributions from many mathematicians ended up leading to a. So it's one thing to be able to kind of encapsulate sort of homoclinic intersections in a nice picture. It's something else to say what the hyperbolic system is. Then you can define hyperbolic systems to be systems that have some general behavior like the horseshoe. And then so this was done. And then the essence of what hyperbolicity was all about was quite thoroughly described in the subsequent years, and it can be summarized in sort of one picture. Or one class of pictures. And what a hyperbolic system is a system that you can cut up or encode as a collection of boxes that get mapped around each other, and when this box here maps across any other box, it squeezes in one direction, stretches in the other, and maps completely across like this picture here. So in all these, you may have lots of these boxes all over the place, finitely many of them, and they, every time they map around, you see this picture of squeezing, stretching, and bending around. Right? So that's the other thing. You have to see squeezing and stretching, so you have to see stretching like, so there has to be some stretching in order to exist, you know, for randomness to exist, but you, why did I start saying this? Oh, but you also have to have bending because, you know, things are in some sort of finite amount of space. You can't have stretching if you don't have some sort of bending somewhere. So that's the summary picture of hyperbolic dynamics. And what Thurston observed was that in the isotopy classes that so if an isotopy class is not of finite order or is not reducible, that is, if you can't cut it up into finitely many pieces, then it has to be like that. It has to be like this, not strictly speaking, but in some sort of So I was saying this here. There's some, if it's not simple in the sense that it's some power is the identity, and it's not decomposable into simpler pieces, then it's topologically hyperbolic, in the sense that. There's some topologically, intrinsically topological reason for which, you know, this isotopy class is not either of the two other possibilities. And what it's doing is that it's stretching across their boxes, and these boxes stretch across one another in a hyperbolic way. Another way of saying this is that there's a representative in the isotopy class, which is essentially hyperbolic in the sense that there are these boxes, right? So this type of isotopy class is called the Pseudo-Nozov isotopy class because of Nozov had worked on these torus maps that have this sort of behavior. And the geometrization theorem of Thurston's is that. So it's a hyperbolization theorem for three manifolds which fiber over the circle. So these manifolds, these suspension manifolds, obviously fiber over the circle because, you know, as you close it up, you know, you can always project to the first coordinate, which then became a circle, right? So these are three manifolds which fiber over the circle, and it says that these such manifolds, the mapping torus of a surface homeomorphism, admits a hyperbolic structure. Then you have to say that this hyperbolic structure is also complete and it also has finite volume, as it turns out, if and only if the isotopy class is of Pseudo-Nozov type. So what this theorem is saying is that this is a fairly large class of three manifolds because, as I said, if you start with a surface homeomorphism, the likely thing to happen is for it to be Pseudo-Nozov. And what this theorem is saying is that for all the three manifolds which you construct out of these surface homeomorphisms, or almost all of them, do carry a hyperbolic metric. That is a metric of constant curvature equal to minus one. So the proof of this theorem and of the previous theorem build upon many subjects initiated by Poincaré, notably topology, I suppose, but also the theories of Fuchsian and Kleinian groups and many more important results in complex analysis, and then a lot of Teichmuller theory, which also was much influenced by Poincaré's work, and ergodic theory as well. I mean, the ergodic theory of the action of Kleinian groups on the sphere at infinity is something that plays an essential role here, and there are many other things that come into these proofs. These are true tour de forces of modern mathematics, and Thurston's contribution, I'm now talking about future here, to these areas are monumental. I mean, I studied much, well, or part of his work, and I don't cease to be amazed at the novelty and the I leave some hint of work for future historians here, that you know, perhaps there'll be a Thurston archives at some point, and people start digging up his correspondence with other people, because there's a lot to be found there. And I think that's all I wanted to say. Thank you very much.
The talk of Milton Lopes, from the Department of Institute of Mathematics of Federal University of Rio.
Good afternoon. Thank you. Thank you, Tatiana, and for inviting me to give this talk. I'm a specialist in fluid dynamics and PD. And I must say that my field has very little that's attributed to Poincaré directly. And so then what is Poincaré and the theory of fluid vortices doing there? And this is the reason why I'm giving this talk. A few years ago, I was walking around in a bookstore in Paris, and I came across this book. And Théorie des Tourbillons is vortex theory. And it is what I work. I've been spent the last 25 years writing papers on this stuff. And as I said, I haven't come across the name of Poincaré in any substantial manner in the story. So it really surprised me to see this. And well, so I bought it, brought it home, and occasionally spent some time reading bits and pieces of it. It's very pretty. And I had no context in which to put this in until today. I heard that Poincaré, this was a series of lectures given in 1892. And so now I know that he was giving a course every year on mathematical physics at Sorbonne. And so I guess this was one of them. I just learned this morning. So I had no context to put this on. But so my homework about a month ago, I got this homework, was to read this and make an account what a modern mathematician working on this field feels and looks like what Poincaré was doing there. How can I account for what Poincaré was doing there? And so what I'm going to tell you is my reading of this and some conclusions I can take out of that. So first, I have to explain to you what it is that he's talking about. What's a vortex? Okay, and nothing better than a few pictures. So these are vortices in water, small scale stuff, pretty much. A larger scale vortex produced by an airplane, that little airplane landing leaves back that vortex that actually is the reason why you have to wait some time and let this thing settle before you can land another plane in the same field. People in engineering have to study the decay of such structures because it's important to economically important. And this is a slightly larger scale vortex. This one made about $40 million in damage back in 2007, a tornado. An even larger scale vortex, and this one this one actually has a name. It's called Hurricane Elena. And if you know me, you know why I like this particular vortex more than others, okay? And if you want an even larger scale vortex, here's another one. The Earth, if you put the Earth beside that thing, it's a little black dot. Okay, so that one is about the diameter of that vortex, about 100 times the diameter of the Earth. Okay, so these are all vortices, and vortices are these rotating structures inside fluids. Okay, so why study vortices? And we continue to study vortices today, but Poincaré, in the introduction of his notes, actually put down some reasons, so I'm going to reproduce his reasons for studying vortices. The first thing he says is that vortices are, I think they're important in meteorology, which is basically the reason why we keep studying them today. And he says that Helmholtz is actually working to make this, why vortices are important in meteorology, more precise. He actually said that in the introduction. Now, this is a little more interesting and intriguing. I hope my translation is okay. My French is a little precarious, but well, my wife actually has better French. I asked her to see if this is okay. She said it was. Okay. So he says that one attempts to find among vortex-like motions an explanation of the universe. Okay, so this is 1892, so pre-quantum mechanics, but atom theory, the atoms were there. And the idea of this matter being these vast empty spaces with the tiny structures inside was a bit uncomfortable. He wanted a sort of a field theory for particles. And the vortices are a surprisingly good guess for what would be a field theory for particles. Now, this is a large-scale continuum mechanical structure, okay, that behaves like a particle for some strange reason. And this is what he's sort of driving at here. He attributes actually this idea to Kelvin, okay, but it seems to me that this is one of the reasons he says, well, maybe a future theory of matter will involve vortices. Now, this is interesting because quantum mechanics completely did away with this idea, except that recently, you'll say that in the last 30, 40 years, this whole thing came back as the quantum vortices in superconductivity and superfluids. So eventually, people actually found important bits of quantum nature that tends to arrange itself like vortices. So this whole idea is coming back to some extent. And also, again, a third reason that he wants to study such things is that there is a very strong formal analogy between electrodynamics and vortex theory. And I'll show you why is that in a bit. Okay? And therefore, you can actually deduce facts from about Maxwell equations, solutions to Maxwell's equations, from the mechanics of vortex motions and vice versa. Okay? So the basic theme of the course that Poincaré was teaching was something called Helmholtz theorem. And Helmholtz theorem is the explanation why vortices are behaving like particles. Okay, so that's one of the things I want to convince you of. Okay, so Poincaré refers, I mean, the word he uses about Helmholtz theorem is le plus grand progress on hydrodynamics ever. Okay, and the most significant result obtained in hydrodynamics. And funny enough, what Poincaré was calling Helmholtz theorem is very familiar for me. It's a common tool, but it doesn't have that name. It's called Kelvin circulation theorem in current hydrodynamics literature. I assume that he may have good reason to call it Helmholtz theorem. Perhaps that would be the right name. But I'll keep the Kelvin circulation theorem because that's a translation of that's a tradition of my culture. Sort of. So I'll keep that name, and one day I'll straighten out who I should attribute it to. But it is a cornerstone of my subject, and there is special case. I mean, both names are associated to the story, so there is special case of Kelvin circulation theorem, which are known as Helmholtz theorem. So they both are there, in some sense. And so the purpose of the lectures is to basically study this result, what he's calling Helmholtz theorem. Some of the consequences that it has, why is it making fluids behave like particles, and explain this connection and the connection with Maxwell electromagnetism. That's his purpose of the talks. Okay, I'll get to that later, but the point is, this is really mathematical physics at the very edge of things when he's talking about. I mean, this is very, there is a very strong group in England studying this stuff. There is if you want a good reference for the state of the art during those times, is a book by Lamb, Horace Lamb. It's called Just Hydrodynamics. It's incredibly boring to read, but it's a treatise. It has everything that you want to know about fluids. It's still today, I open it and I find everything. So it's a classical subject. It's been around for a while. And Poincaré gives it a completely different take than, and of course, there's a strong school in Germany as well. And not that much in France, at least. So he's picking up stuff that is very interesting for people both in England and Germany and sort of putting it together in a completely unique, as far as I can see, a completely unique way. And that's what I want to explore a bit. Okay? Now, so Poincaré starts his notes by, so let me go over what the what he does in the book. So Poincaré starts deriving the equations of fluid motion, both in Eulerian and Lagrangian frames. He uses these words, actually. Eulerian frame is the laboratory frame, x, y, z, and t, the usual stuff. Lagrangian frame is particle, variables tied to the particle motion in fluids. Okay, and so if you look at the equations in the so-called Eulerian frame, you get this... this system here, which is called Euler's equation, he doesn't call it that, but it's the Euler equation. But what in fact is the first this first group of equations is second Newton's law, and this is continuity equation for density. Okay, he looks at this system in two different ways. Something we call these days isentropic gas dynamics case, but in the special case where this density rho here is just a function of pressure and there's no temperature in the story. So that's it's a strong physical restriction, okay? And the point is that this is one case. If you put rho equals rho p, the grad p over rho becomes a gradient itself. He's also assuming that f is a gradient, so this whole thing here is a gradient in that case. And also, so there's two cases. One is the variable density dependent on pressure, and the other case is just density constant, which is he calls it the liquid case. And that is incompressible flow, because you take rho constant, this is gone, and you just have divergence u equals zero. That equation becomes divergence u equals zero, so the flow becomes incompressible. Okay. So these two cases, he derives this equation more or less carefully from first principle, physical first principles. And I'm sure if mathematicians reading that description will get really baffled, because it's hard to follow the way he does it. I do it, and I actually wrote a book where I do this, and I take twice as long to do it, and students don't understand. So, okay, fine. Lagrangian particles would start with u of x, xt equals u of x and t, and x is the solution, the ODE, the solution of the ODE, x dot equals u, and then you follow particle trajectories, and you can re-express these equations in these terms. I'll get to that in a second. So these equations were first derived by Euler in 1757. So we are sort of Poincaré is sort of halfway between Euler and now, okay? 120 years and a bit after Euler. So they were already pretty old when he was talking about them, these equations. Okay. Now, what is he talking about? What's Kelvin circulation theorem? Okay, now look at the Lagrangian map associated with the velocity of a fluid. So I'm just talking about the transport or how the particles are going. So I'm giving a name, x of alpha t. Alpha is an initial position. So x of alpha t is just a trajectory of a fluid particle. Start out with a closed curve in space in the initial data plane, in the initial data space, and evolve it using the fluid. So if you do that, the circulation of velocity around this material curve, what's called the material curve, is constant in time. Okay, so this is what he's calling this deep fact that he's talking about. So start with a curve, gamma naught, evolve it in time. You get the curve gamma of t, and you look at the circulation of velocity around this curve, and this is constant in time. Okay, this is Kelvin circulation theorem. Now the point is that this theorem is saying that somehow the circulation of velocity around closed curves cannot be created or destroyed. Okay, it's a constant of motion for incompressible ideal fluids, incompressible fluids without friction, and it's this that for some reason is making the fluids behave like particles. It gives persistence to this circular motion. Okay, some kind of physical reality beyond what you would expect. Okay, so for this discussion to go on, you have to introduce what's called the vorticity. The vorticity is just the curl of velocity. And by Stokes' theorem, if you look at the vorticity is a vector field. And by Stokes' theorem, if you take any surface whose boundary is that curve gamma of t, right, the integral of the vorticity, the normal component of vorticity on the surface is equal to the circulation, so that's conserved as well. Okay, so this is just to be a consequence of Stokes' theorem that Poincaré immediately calls attention to. So let me just introduce some terminology to go on. Lines of current are integral curves of velocity at a fixed time. So these are not particle trajectories, just you take the velocity for a frozen time and look at the integral curves. Vortex lines are integral curves of vorticity, which is another vector field. And vortex surfaces are surfaces tangent to vorticity, and vortex tubes are vortex surfaces in the form of a tube. Okay, the whole story now focuses very much on vortex tubes from Poincaré. Now, first consequence of the Kelvin circulation theorem, if you start with a vortex surface, then you evolve in time and you stay a vortex surface for all time. Okay? So you start with a vortex surface, something for which vorticity is tangent. Okay? The curl velocity is tangent to this. And you let this evolve in time using the Lagrangian map, you get another surface, and you know at future times, the vorticity is still tangent. How do you prove this? How do you reduce this to Kelvin circulation theorem? It's a very pretty argument. So you are a vortex surface if and only if you take any contractible loop inside the surface and the circulation velocity there is zero. I actually wrote this down. So take any contractible closed loop in the surface. Okay. Of course, if you are a vortex surface, the normal component of velocity is zero on that bit of surface. So use Stokes' theorem and say the circulation has to be zero. And of course, it's easy to show that it's actually if and only if. So you characterize vortex surfaces by those for which these closed contractible curves have zero circulation. And then this is preserved by the flow. And that's why being a vortex surface is preserved. Okay, so if you are a vortex tube, again by Stokes, the circulation of velocity also around any closed curve wrapping around the curve is constant. So now you look at the vortex tube. So this is one surface where the vorticity is zero, and now you compute the circulation around anything wrapping around this tube once, and that circulation is constant, not only independent. It's not only independent of where you take the curve, but it's also independent of time. So this thing, he calls it the momentum of the tube, and that carries the amount of rotation that's going around inside that tube. And that tube is preserved, so it will stay there. That amount of rotation will stay there forever. You can see how topological the subject really is. Okay, now this is an important issue at this stage, at least for Poincaré. You can see how although this is deep inside mathematical physics, and certainly the people who were working on this, both in Germany and England, weren't really aware of that, but Poincaré immediately sees that this is a very topological subject hiding behind the PDEs. Okay? So second corollary, the momentum of a vortex tube is independent of time, and this is the quantity that carries the rotation around. So he derives then this equation, which is called the vorticity equation, from the fact that this momentum is independent of time. Then he does an approximation with thin tubes and uses the incompressibility of the fluid and derives this equation, again, sort of from first principles. These days, in my book, I derive that equation by taking the curl of the velocity equation, and it comes out, and use the divergence free condition, and it comes out. He actually derives it by doing some calculations with integrals. And in fact, in some sense, when I prove the Kelvin circulation theorem, I take the velocity equation, take the curl, get this equation, and then derive the Kelvin circulation theorem of this equation here. So that's the order where we do things. He actually did the opposite way. Now, one of the consequences of this is that I found out something I didn't know before, is that the Kelvin circulation theorem is true for isentropic flow in 3D, something I didn't know. Okay. When I do it, I have to assume incompressibility. Okay. So, but anyway, so a consequence of the Kelvin circulation theorem is the particular form of the transport equation for vorticity. Now, one important bit of data here, that this equation has a lot of structure to it. And one of the things it does is to say, if I, this is transport by the velocity of this vector of vorticity, and this is, we call this stretching of vorticity. And first, a lot of turbulence is hidden in this omega dot grad u. There's a lot of stuff hidden in that omega dot grad u term. Second, if you start with vorticity equal to zero and a particle trajectory, this kind of term, this is a linear equation for vorticity, the linear first order equation for vorticity, system for vorticity. And this kind of system, if you start with initial data zero, the solution is zero forever. Okay. So one of the things it does is that it really says that you cannot create vorticity out of nothing. Okay. It's one of the things that you can see out of this equation. You can stretch it, you can sort of deform it, but you cannot create it or destroy it. So still consequences, one a nice one that he gets out of this story is look at stationary flow. Stationary flow, you take you assume that the flow does not depend on time, in particular the vorticity does not depend on time. And then this equation reads u dot grad omega equals omega dot grad u. This means the commutator between the vector fields u and omega is zero. And again, something, I don't know if people how easily people saw it. Poincaré saw it very easily. If you have two vector fields that commute, they generate a foliation of R3. Okay, so these are steady flows, and they commute, they generate a foliation of R3. Once you know there is a foliation, it's hard to, it's very easy to find out which a function that whose level surfaces are that foliation, okay? And the function is this. This is the potential for the forcing of the flow, the pressure over rho, and minus u squared over 2. If the flow is irrotational, this foliation actually is, it's not a foliation, it's just a constant everywhere. Okay, so this would be Bernoulli's theorem, but what he proved there is a big generalization of Bernoulli's theorem, just waving his hands with topological arguments, basically. Okay. And something that people would find very costly and hard to understand in those days. Okay. So the proof begins by noting the stationary vorticity equation says precisely that the velocity and vorticity commute as vector fields. And then once you know that there is a foliation, it's easy to approach to find out that these functions are orthogonal to both. Okay. So further consequences determine, and now, and here things get interesting. You start looking at how to determine velocity from vorticity. This very traditional issue in electrodynamics, and it's an analogous of a very traditional issue in electromagnetism, how to determine the electric field from the magnetic field and vice versa. So for simply connected domains, this is easy. For more complicated domains, then you get into this mess that the topology makes you. And the traditional way of doing this is just wave Hodge theory at the problem, and it disappears. But of course, he didn't have Hodge theory to do it. So what he did was, at least in very specific cases, what he does in the book is doubly and triply periodic domains. He sort of gets Hodge theory by hand, constructing solutions of the Laplace. And the point is that this is not simply topology, but topology and PD mixed together, which in modern days it's something that we. People in PD deal with fairly easily, but in those days it was rather unusual. Okay, but he does using these ideas from complex analysis, and he sort of derives Hodge theory by hand. He clearly understands what the issue is, the set of harmonic forms and so on. It's finite dimensional and how it relates to topology, but something that really would be encoded many decades afterwards. Okay. The analogy between electromagnetism and incompressible flow in the stationary case is very easy. Maxwell's equations and the fluid equations are exactly the same in the stationary case. The velocity is electric field and the vorticity is the magnetic field. Okay. He calls attention to that, and then he can derive a few things from one side to the other, including in this particular problem of determining velocity from vorticity. And then he goes on and finds a Hamiltonian system buried in the story. Okay, so moving on, he looks at the motion of thin straight vortex tubes in two-dimensional flow. He finds that these things obey a Hamiltonian system called the point vortex equation. He didn't discover this. This was known, but he clearly likes this bit of the story a lot. So he derives the equations, which is complicated. He derives the equations for this Hamiltonian system, proves the integrability of the three-point system. And in fact, the fact is the four-point system is not integrable, was only proved about 20 years ago. He derives the motion of vortex pairs in the plane. This is a tour de force mixing PDE and ODEs and Hamiltonian formalism. The single vortex in a disk, straight channel and annulus. And this is probably his. It is not a result that I've seen quoted before. It would be regarded as trivial with modern machinery. But he uses the conformal invariance of this Hamiltonian system. And the conformal invariance is very subtle. It's not really just say the system is invariant. It's quite a bit more complicated than that. But he understands this conformal, how the system behaves under conformal transformations very well. He picks up a general simply connected domain, maps it into a disk, and uses the way he derived the motion of single vortex in the disk to show that the single vortex trajectory on any simply connected domain is closed. And therefore, there is invariant functions there. You can't, for fluid flow. So there's further topics on the. This is all I'm going to do. I'm going to talk about detail. There's further topics. He talks about axisymmetric flows, which is the motion of smoke rings, even more complicated to derive in some sense. He talks about vortex sheets and boundary behavior. He puts the fluid in a container and vortex sheets are this situation where the vorticity itself is a measure supported on a surface. Okay, so here the vorticity is some kind of, and of course he doesn't have this language and therefore things get rather complicated to describe. But he does realize that in a surface along which the velocity has a tangential discontinuity is a surface where there's a lot of vorticity wrapped around, and this is important for many reasons. He finds out some more complicated conservation. This is classical stuff that he derives, the conservation of helicity and moment of inertia, and then he discusses stability of steady motions, which is a neat subject. And he would actually do another series of lectures 10 years later on stable steady motions. Now this is a very simple description, but he also sort of gets out something which is considered, again, a very important issue in the subject, which is the Kelvin-Helmholtz instability. I'll show you what it is in a second. And talks about flows with a free surface, flows on the, again, a very important issue. The effect, a little bit the effect of friction, how this picture, because all this picture is for flows without friction, so he describes a little bit how friction affects the whole story. And of course, the real big step on understanding this whole story is where the vorticity comes from, and that he didn't know, because it was discovered by Prandtl in 1904. Okay, so perhaps the biggest advance in hydrodynamics after Kelvin circulation theory is the boundary layer theory of Prandtl in 1904, which Poincaré didn't know and probably rather liked when it came out. And so this is Kelvin-Helmholtz instability, just to say what, you start with a vortex sheet up there and make a tiny perturbation. So if you put a straight line, a vortex sheet just stays there. You make a tiny perturbation, the perturbation grows due to dynamics and creates some rather nice complicated story. And this instability really is really very important in understanding how the small scales involved in a fluid motion appear spontaneously, apparently. Okay. So here's, just to wrap up, first, what strikes me as remarkable in these notes. First, the focus in the interface between physics and, he never loses the sight of the physics. He's interested in the concrete behavior of fluids. He proves theorems, and his theorems are pretty solid in the modern sense. But it's really, the focus is really into the physics of the behavior of fluids. And his choice of topics is towards that. But it's very iconoclastic. So there is the tight connection between physics and mathematics. But there is a certain idiosyncrasy in the story. So let me put it this way. As I said, you look at Lamb's book. Lamb's is the vade mecum of the knowledge of fluids for this period. And Lamb is incredibly boring to read because it's this enormous collection of examples, some very deep stuff in there, but it's, you go on and this is an example, and very linear, very perturbative theory. You look at Poincaré's book and he's really having fun. And this is perhaps one of the reasons why the physicists didn't take him as seriously they should. He's not taking the subject that seriously. He gets so enchanted with the beauty of the mathematics that he, you know, chooses topics in a way that's very different from what a physicist would choose. Okay? And one of the things that comes out very clearly from reading these notes is how much he loves topology. Okay? Which is something that even today, in my field, is still a dialogue between physicists and mathematicians. And topology is always a problem if you're talking to a physicist in this field. Okay? Maybe in quantum field theory it isn't these days. But certainly the people who do classical fluid dynamics, engineers in physics who are worried about classical fluid dynamics, have a hard time with topological arguments and considerations. But Poincaré is deep in there, in the topology. And in fact, he focuses on the topology because that's how you avoid the hard, hairy calculations that's involved in anything you do in the subject. Okay? So this is a sharp contrast between what would a contemporary text, what would one of the contemporary texts in the subject would look like, and what Poincaré did. Another thing that strikes me is that a lot of what he was doing, the stuff that he was focusing on, and he felt was important or amusing on the subject, it really developed in the years afterwards into these huge research programs that are still being carried out. Okay? So point vortex dynamics, which is something that people regarded as a minor issue in the turn of the previous century, is still an ongoing research program. The people dedicate conferences to it. There's journal issues dedicated to point vortex dynamics. It's a Hamiltonian system, but with lots of nice specific structure interest to that. Another thing that developed into a huge endeavor is topological fluid dynamics. So this topological aspect of this fluid motion was recognized maybe from Arnold started playing with this in the 60s, and then people caught on. And these days, there is a school of people thinking about topological fluid dynamics, or thinking about this 3D flow in a topological sense. There's an absolutely gorgeous paper in the Annals this year where people prove the existence of a steady solution of the Euler's equation with a vortex tube that's knotted like a trefoil. It's an absolutely gorgeous paper, and it's incredibly hard to do because, again, you're playing topology and PD can be rather complicated. And but anyways, topological fluid dynamics is an ongoing concern and very much alive. And also the emphasis that he has, the focus on coherent structures, is something that people weren't that interested in, but in these days it's really the focus of the subject because of turbulence. Of course, the word that doesn't appear anywhere in these notes, but it is the current interest in this field, is turbulence. Okay? And on the other hand, the analogy with electromagnetism sort of disappeared from the field. No one's really cared about that because there's no waves in the fluid. The fluid equations are very different, and there isn't that many waves in it. Again, the book is very elegant mathematically, differently from other texts on the subject. Okay, the notation is clean, the flow of ideas is very clean, very pleasant for a mathematician to read. And I should say this, this was not Poincaré's field. He's sort of reading this from the German and British sources. He has no major contributions to the subject that are attributed to him. These notes don't seem to be very cited, so they don't seem to influence the development of the subject in the 20th century. And this perhaps unfortunate. If people had taken these notes a little more seriously, I think the subject might have developed differently. Okay? And also the notes are very modern in flavor and focus. So I could easily pick up these notes, do an update, add some results, some ideas that developed in the past 120 years, and I could still use the basic structure of these notes for an introductory course today. Okay? And it'll be useful, it'll be interesting for the students, and this is to me very surprising, and perhaps the answer that I give a question that was posed, so why weren't people paying attention to Poincaré in probability theory, and perhaps it's the same thing here. Okay? Because he was a late 20th century mathematician in exile in the beginning of the 20th century. He was thinking like people would think in a very natural way for a mathematician trained in the 70s or 80s. Okay? He was thinking in a very natural way for me. But I think for the people who are working on those days, the linear people who were thinking more linearly, and It was hard to understand where he was, what he was driving at. So, that's it. Thank you. Couple of Spaniards. I'd have to check the. Not someone famous from the field. New people.
I just have a comment about that. I think his book was written. Came out of the course he gave in Cambridge. It was his lecture notes, and of course the whole Cambridge tripos system built on problems and so forth and so on. So I think, you know, it was the kind of, that was the original.
I see.
Motivation for it, and so which will kind of explain the way in which it's written, and in fact, I mean, it was very useful for him. I mean, it kind of got him his main job in Manchester and so forth. So, but you know, so he was kind of coming from a different perspective to Poincaré. But I think I loved your talk. I thought it was really great. It's really interesting to have this huge enthusiasm for Poincaré now. So thank you.
Thank you.
It's your turn now?
Hmm?
No. Well, anyway, so thank you very much. Very interesting also because apparently it's still regarded as one of the kind of top topics for the Clay Institute around Navier-Stokes equation and so on. So you followed mainly the pure mathematical path to fluid dynamics.
That's right.
But of course, it's now a huge theory with big importance to applications, especially numerical and fluid dynamics, right? Computational fluid dynamics.
Yes.
And so I'm wondering, because I'm rather a foreigner to this computational stuff, whether there are kind of still methods used from function theory and topology, which is the main concern here. In these modern theories, which have application value for applications.
Yeah, absolutely. Actually, the point vortex system itself, the Hamiltonian system, is still used as a numerical application, a numerical approximation for, you know, the practical reasons. In fact, it's regarded as a very modern, very good way of approximating the fluids equation and other equations of this kind. Mm-hmm. There is the topology of the knottedness, the way that this. So another aspect you might ask yourself: okay, is it useful to consider the purely inviscid models? And the fact is, yes. Because for fluids in practice, quite often the viscosity really is very small. Okay, the knowledge about fluids, about inviscid fluids, still regarded as very important to even the point of designing numerical methods or understanding what's going on an actual airplane and so on. And finally, as I said, there is turbulence. This is the big ticket issue, because even the physics of turbulence is not there's turbulence. I don't know who the sentence is. People say, but someone said, maybe Kolmogorov did. Vorticity is the sinews of turbulence. Okay? If you are to understand turbulence, you have to understand vorticity. Okay, and vorticity is topological in nature, so turbulence has to be topological in nature, and so this is the big ticket item in this story. Not the Navier-Stokes million-dollar problem, but turbulence. Okay.
Yes, I internally enjoyed your talk, and I appreciate the comparison you made with Lamb. Another point, a contemporary source would be Love's articles in the Encyclopedia de Mathematische Wissenschaften, which we have another Brit then. And I think this may be a partially explanation to follow up on June's remark about the tripos and who the professors are teaching to and their teaching methods. Obviously, if you're teaching to an exam, that's going to mean you're going to be lecturing in a different fashion. Poincaré was not teaching to an exam. No. Seems like I think you're right. He's teaching to his joy for topology and just for doing these calculations. But the other consideration is that this is in French. This was not translated into English or German. Very seldom referred to anywhere in contemporary literature. So yeah, if it did not have posterity, there's a linguistic barrier. The Americans were not sending grad students to Paris anymore for physics. They sent a few mathematicians. The physicists were all going to Germany. So there's a real dearth of young talent coming to Paris and listening to Poincaré's lectures on vorticity, what have you. So mm-hmm. I think this at least explains in part the difficulty of Paris as a university center to attract young talent from outside France, and of course, you know, they have a limited pool in France themselves. And then, of course, World War I is pretty nasty too.
That's right.
So, thank you very much.
Thank you for your talk, and I have a question for you, but perhaps André can also answer if you have, because it's a general question. Because when we say that we find in Poincaré a topological point of view, we are using our definition of topology. And I would like, but effectively what was there is was some aspects of what we now could call topological. So I would like to know if you could precise which are these aspects in a more Poincaré's language.
Yeah, of course he's not using that word. My reading of the book, it's very easy for me to tell, because it's when you do PDE, most of what you do is actual hard calculation, Bessel functions. Integrate here, integrate there, estimate with the integral of volume. Poincaré is actually using soft arguments. Deform this thing here, and you can actually see that something is constant and it will stay constant as you deform. This sort of thinking I'm calling topological. Invariance under this whole, the invariance under this whole set of deformations, stuff that is invariant under deformations, is very much at the heart of topology, and it's something that he uses very adroitly, which I think most people in the classical fluid dynamics school would have a hard time with. I mean, of course, this is complex variables. I mean, the truth is this topological thinking is really coming out of a mastery of complex variables that Poincaré had available to him, and maybe other people didn't even today. Okay. But that is where the topological thing. This is the topological thinking that I'm talking about. This counting is noticing that there is this momentum around the tube that is conserved, and how this is really a topological invariant of the flow. And when he's trying to build this vortex methods, this is a funny comment. He does the vortex dynamics on a domain with two holes, okay, in the plane. Now this is a complicated problem, because it's hard to pinpoint. Let me put it this way: the first time I know this thing was actually done with the PDE, writing down what the equations are for the domain of two holes, okay, was in the 90s, okay, by a couple of Swedes. Before, people didn't really know how to deal with the domain with two holes, because if you try to do it explicitly, it's impossible. You don't have special functions to write things down with two holes. And of course, Poincaré can do it, because he's really doing arguments that doesn't involve writing down explicitly what the formulas are. He says, oh, there is this sort of solution of Laplace equation floating around here. And he constructs it by doing cuts on the two holes, very topological, very complex variable sort of construction. He shows that it exists. And then he does all kinds of arguments, but just by knowing that such a thing exists. And people would be very uncomfortable in thinking this way. They would want a specific formula using Bessel functions and so on. This doesn't exist for this problem. So I guess that's my point. This is something that a modern PDEist is very comfortable with. You look at a solution that you know exists, and then you play with it. But people 100 years ago weren't at all comfortable with thinking this way. Okay.
So I don't have any very significant thing to say, but you know, Dennis Sullivan at some point was interested in fluid motions, and he was interested in this because of some relationship with the Beltrami equation. But in any case, so I was very sort of surprised to see Poincaré so comfortable with the, you know, Dennis is a topologist by training, and you know, his arguments were always like that. You know, oh, you take a curve here, you push it over there, and then the, you know, the vorticity, some of funk, you know, there's a tensor that, you know, gets and Poincaré, you know, is an answer, you know, in sort of retrospect. It's very impressive to see Poincaré so comfortable with these things that, you know, modern topologists are doing, right? So, and in fact, when reading books in three manifold theory as well, I mean, it's incredible how comfortable with these topological constructions that, you know, cut and paste Poincaré also was. It's this freedom to do things in without formulas that's just amazing. But anyway, I don't know if this.
That's exactly my field too.
Four.